Hachette Audio presents Lessons from the COVID War, an investigative report written by the COVID Crisis Group. Read by Derek Shetterly. One. From tragedy to possibility. We were supposed to lay the groundwork for a national COVID commission. The COVID crisis group formed at the beginning of 2021, 1 year into the pandemic. We thought the U.S. government would soon create or facilitate a commission to study the biggest global crisis so far in the 21st century. It has not. The 34 members of our group have done a lot of work on the COVID war, both as part of this group and in our day jobs. We held listening sessions with nearly 300 people. We organized task forces. We mapped out agendas. We shared insights across our different backgrounds and did a substantial amount of research. We have learned a lot. With no commission in sight, we feel a duty to share at the beginning of 2023 how we size up the COVID war. A year into the crisis, we spoke with a doctor named Ashish Jha, who is now coordinating the government's COVID response. Back in 2021, he told us how, with the constant early mornings and late nights, he still couldn't process what he had been going through for more than a year. Being a medical doctor, naturally he had a diagnosis. He called it reflection deficit disorder. This short book is designed to alleviate the symptoms of reflection deficit disorder. It is a short course of treatment, available to all sufferers. This disorder, this amnesia, can kill. We talked to a key figure in the crisis, one of those who helped originate the successful Operation Warp Speed that rushed vaccines to Americans, Peter Marks. Marks said it was stunning to him that there was so little understanding of the lessons from this war. Some experiences troubled him, Marks admitted. Sometimes he wished that, like one of those characters in the movie Men in Black, someone could administer a neuralizer and blank out his memories of certain meetings. But as Marks watched what was happening in the continuing COVID war, it seemed to him at the end of 2022 as if the U.S. government and the country were repeating the same mistakes he remembered from the spring of 2020. We do not promise a permanent cure for reflection deficit disorder. We cannot offer the kind of exhaustive investigative report that a COVID commission might have produced, interviewing layers of officialdom across the country and around the world, and piecing together thousands of key documentary records. What we can offer is our sketch of the whole picture, our sense of how we think the pieces fit together. There are already many books and stories about this war. We step back and appraise the entire landscape, focusing on what we believe mattered most. We have an advantage. Working together, we helped each other make sense of this overwhelming experience. Our take goes beyond some of the stock narratives. Our views don't fit neatly with partisan political arguments on either side in American politics. We believe this is a strength. We wrote this book for our fellow citizens, experts and non-experts alike, who have already read hundreds, if not thousands, of articles about the pandemic as it happened. We will not spend much time just recapitulating what you likely already know. We try to be more analytical, to zoom in on what mattered most. While being analytical, we have tried to write plainly. We are not writing the way we would write up our results for a scientific or medical journal. We think you, like us, want to get past the enormous jumble of information and make some sense of it all. What just happened to us, and why? How could we do better? A global war. We think it helps to see this crisis as a war, a global war. Some of us who work in healthcare don't like these sorts of warlike metaphors. Some of us do. Conceiving of this struggle as a war does help people think about how to organize collective action against a terrifying danger. By the end of January 2020, the U.S. government should have started mobilizing to a war footing against a terrifying pandemic danger. It was not ready to do this. It did not start really trying to mobilize fully until about 2 months later, and even then in a haphazard way. The world waged a war against an alien invader. In this case, the invader was not some giant from outer space. It was not an unknown threat. It was a viral microorganism, invisible to the naked eye. In all of human history, only during the last 100 years have humans been able to even see a virus. Rather than say alien, scientists just say a new virus is novel. When the invader is especially contagious and deadly, racing beyond some particular region, we call these invasions pandemics. Throughout human history, pandemics have been on the short list of the gravest threats to society and civilization. An outbreak of plague in the 6th century helped usher in what people recall as the Dark Ages. Another such outbreak in the 14th century nearly destroyed large swaths of the populations in both Europe and Asia. Outbreaks of smallpox wrecked societies throughout the Western Hemisphere after the arrivals of Europeans. The great influenza virus pandemic of 1918 and 19 killed more people than the First World War. Though it was perhaps no more than 1/4 as deadly per infection as the 1918-19 influenza virus, the COVID-19 pandemic was the most deadly and disruptive global pandemic since that one. The risk of these threats has sped up. The world has changed. In our extremely interconnected world, with its novel pressures on wildlife habitats, its interactions with livestock, its burgeoning experiments with synthetic biology, and the impact of climate change on biological risks, there is no particular reason to assume there will not be another such pandemic, relatively soon, in a matter of years, not centuries. This is why we must take a hard, searching self-inventory right now and face what we find. COVID-19 is the name of a disease, Coronavirus Infection Disease 2019. The disease is caused by a virus called SARS-CoV-2. That is a way of saying Severe Acute Respiratory Syndrome Coronavirus Version 2. Version 1 broke out in southern China between 2002 and 2004 and was at least 20 times more lethal per infection than our current Version 2. Fortunately for humanity, Version 1 spread more slowly than Version 2. Nor did version 1 easily spread invisibly and asymptomatically. But this was a kind of biological luck. There is no law that guarantees a deadlier disease cannot also be extremely contagious. And there is no reason to assume the next one might not come soon or be deadlier. Our story of the response to COVID-19 is about how American leaders and institutions handled a new kind of war. Given our own limitations, we will focus mainly on how Americans handled this war, but we keep an eye on what other countries did, and we keep in mind what other countries needed. Imagine that you're a leader getting ready to wage such a war. You would face 4 basic challenges: prevent and warn, size up the danger, engage citizens, and track the enemy. Contain the attack, keep the enemy out of the country, or confine its spread. Defend our communities. Protect not only lives, but also our way of life with proper health care and non-medical measures. Fight back. Develop and deploy medical countermeasures such as tests, medicines, and vaccines. And it was a global war against a global invasion. All these things needed to be done rapidly and on a global scale. There were heroes. There are lessons. The world war against this invader, COVID-19, has not gone well. No country's performance is more disappointing than that of the United States. America went into this war with unsurpassed scientific knowledge. Once at war, its politicians were willing to spend whatever it took. Thousands of people and organizations made heart-rending, life-saving efforts. Yet, our institutions did not meet the moment. They did not have adequate practical strategies or capabilities to prevent, to warn, to defend their communities, or fight back in a coordinated way in the United States and globally. The members of our group are angry. They're angry because they feel that good Americans all over the country were let down by ineffective institutions, a slow and uneven initial response, shoddy defenses, and inadequate leadership. We came away from many of our discussions consistently impressed with the ingenuity and dedication of people all over the country and beyond. That is why so many of us are so frustrated. Americans improvise.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.